something that's set at the center of economic activity. And that's not the only commodity whose price has gone through this dizzying heights and lows. Of course, all the other sources of energy have done similar, have gone through similar paths, but so did food. And so did metals. For the case of Ukraine, it's metals. Ukraine is basically a metals story. 42% of Ukraine's exports has to do with steel. It's either steel or rolled sheets or something made out of steel. So for that country, it was a huge shock to see this drop in the price of metal, in the price of steel. And I can quote you the extent. It went down to less than half in a matter of 4 months in 2008. And guess what? Ukraine's budget just couldn't cope, and the whole country couldn't cope, and it was a huge crisis. So these are just the short-term shocks. Then there are long-term shocks. And these are, of course, obvious to all of you. One is extreme income inequality. Income inequality has a cycle which is measured decades, but over a century. Over a century, you see, for example, in the US, income inequality was highest just before the Great Depression. And then, you know, there was some mess of the Second World War and the run-up to that, but after the Second World War, income inequality continuously declined for 2.5 decades. And then it began a relentless rise. Similar things have happened. Essentially, all countries accept the socialist law, where if you measure it only by income, there wasn't very much change until the beginning of transition. And then, in a very compressed period of time, you had a huge increase in inequality. And essentially, transition economies have caught up with the level of inequality of pretty extremely unequal countries like Brazil. Inequality in these countries and the region, it's not higher in an absolute, on an absolute measure, for example, the Gini coefficient, than in other regions, in the region. However, the speed with which they have attained this level of inequality is phenomenal. So inequality is something that is important, and I consider it a shock, because right now I sense that we are approaching somewhere that we cannot go very much higher, without being very severely disruptive to social needs. And we are facing this. And I will, just one moment later, right, let me just lay out and put on the table all the shocks that I would like to ask you to consider, and then make the argument why actually you have to consider all of them together. The next one is demographic change. That, again, is a very long-term shift. In any other country, I would be talking about aging. This is not a country where I can talk about aging. However, you do have a demographic issue. You have a huge amount of young people coming to the labor force. You just must create jobs. If you don't, the better outturn is that they just leave your country, and that's a huge loss of human capital. The worst outturn is that you have a very large number of young people without anything useful to do, and then they will turn to do something else which will be good. So that's a shock, the demographics. Incidentally, for possible is one of, in my mind, one of the biggest possible ways of gaining a comparative advantage. If you somehow manage to educate these young people, you will be pretty much alone in a Europe which is aging. That's a humongous comparative. And you can gain tremendously from it. So not only is the argument that you should invest heavily in human capital, the argument is not only because otherwise those guys will be up to no good, but this is your chance to be very competitive in a world to which you want to, in a part of the world to which you want to converge, that is Europe. And finally, one long-term shocks, climate change. That's the longest one. Climate change is on us. If you define it properly, which is not just talking about the change in the average temperature over year over year, but you actually define it properly and you include volatility in the ways that you observe climate change, you see it's already on us. The reasonable people can disagree whether or not this hockey stick is really the hockey stick of average temperatures. But I don't think you will find anyone who will argue, no, the weather is the same. Grandfathers and grandmothers, they keep telling us, oh, when I was young, weather was better. We had snow in the winter and we had nice warm weather in the summer. And no floods, or very fewer number of floods and fewer droughts. Okay, the reason we want to consider the long-term ones is that if you want to address those two policies, when do you have to start right now? When climate change hits is 40 years away from now, around 2050. But if you reasonably want to do something about it, you have to start right now. So that's the whole point of the confluence of shocks. Short-term shocks, you have to do something about right now, by definition. Longer-term shocks, you have to do something about right now, right now. Because any reasonable policies that people can come up with do require long lead times. Okay, so this is my vision of the crisis. Take an onion, layer on layer on layer. That's how I think about it. Now, how would you address a complex thing like this? Well, if you take any one of these shocks in isolation, there is a doctor who knows what to order. To cyclical downturn, you will gain some interventions and you increase the budget deficit and you support demand better. If it's financial crisis, you want decent supervision, you want to make sure banks are reasonably well capitalized. Sure that the supervision is not just in single countries, but actually across regions, because we have international financial conglomerates. It goes across countries, but it goes across business areas, insurance and banking, just because this conglomerate is actually vulnerable, and so on. If you have roller coaster commodity prices, you want to take a look at the market structure, and then there is a monopoly pricing. In to the extent of monopoly pricing, you want to regulate it. And so if it's income inequality, fiscal policy is the answer, or part of the answer, and education, actually, access to education for all is another part of the answer, at least in terms of attaining equality, in terms of opportunity, if not outcomes, but that is more. If it's demographic shifts, you do, if you are facing aging, you look at your pension system, you look at your health system. If it's the young people, Kosovo's case, you take a look at your education system and whatever ways you can raise to that will include health system, of course, and creating jobs so that they have job experience. And so now the point here is that what you want to do is create a cocktail of the instruments that you find optimal for each individual one. And then of course you face exactly the problems that doctors face when they prescribe more than one medicine. You have interaction across these medicines, and some block the effect of the others. Others act synergistically. So you have to worry about that aspect. But the best possible policies in this very complex situation are those that will try or seek to address as many of these aspects as possible. And then you deal with the rest of it somehow. And there are some synergistic examples at the top. When you spend on public works, that actually can be a very nice part of fiscal expansion. If you raise carbon tax to address the global warming aspect, that actually creates revenue for you. And using that revenue, you can either reduce inequality or you can subsidize some production companies that are more conducive to low carbon emission. You can expand your spending more, or these are the easy ones. Now,